This Civic Media podcast is sponsored by UW Organ and Tissue Donation. Organ donations are desperately needed, and now is the right time to become an organ donor. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. Go to heroicdeed.com.
Broadcasting across the state of Wisconsin on the Civic Media Radio Network and around the world on the Civic Media app, this is the Dom Salvia Show. And now, here's your host, Dom Salvia.
And welcome to the Dom Salvia Show. You can be part of this fine production, 855-752-4842, 855-75-CIVIC, just PS on the board. James Santelle, former U.S. attorney and host of Amicus Law Review, broadcasting here every Saturday morning from 9 to 11 a.m. Check that out, Jim. Thanks for sticking around, man.
Oh, it's a pleasure, my friend. Good to talk about all these things with all your callers, too.
lots of topics today. Jessica, need your help here. We do have some sound from President Joe Biden today.
Sure do.
Just a few cuts. Want to get that out there for your consideration as well to introduce this perhaps as part of our conversation. You ready, Jess? Let's start with Biden today, the peaceful transfer of power, cut number one.
Yesterday, I spoke with President-elect Trump to congratulate him on his victory. And I assured him that I'd direct my entire administration to work with his team to ensure a peaceful and orderly transition.
Peaceful.
On January 20th,
we'll
have a peaceful transfer of power here in America.
Let's keep going. The president speaking today, cut number two.
I also spoke with Vice President Harris. She's been a partner and a public servant. She ran an inspiring campaign, and everyone got to see something that I learned early on to respect so much, her character.
President Joe Biden talking about defeat, cut number three.
A defeat does not mean we are defeated. We lost this battle. The America of your dreams is calling for you to get back up.
Get it back up. Come on. It's only been a couple of days, man. Still a little hungover. Let's keep going. The president cut four.
I know for some people, it's a time for victory, to state the obvious.
Yeah.
For others, it's a time of loss. Campaigns are contests of competing visions. The country chooses one or the other.
Yep. He's absolutely right. And this country has made a choice.
It's all about choosing.
It certainly is. And I accept the choice. I'm not challenging the election, but I will certainly challenge you to hold him to whatever expectation you voted him on, because he's Donald Trump. He will certainly eventually disappoint.
And are there mainline Republicans out there who are noting the difference in reactions when Donald Trump was defeated a little over 4 years or so ago? What happened? Not only calling the country to insurrection, but also running into federal courts, state courts, 60 of them. When a Democrat gets defeated, what does she do? She stands up in front of a crowd at Howard University and graciously says that I have called my opponent and I have told him that I wish him the best and I congratulate him. The fight goes on. That's the difference. That's the difference. And that's the rule of law that caller was talking about before, Jeannie as well.
President Joe Biden spoke today. Let's play the next one, please, Jess.
We accept the choice the country made. I've said many times, you can't love your country only when you win. You can't love your neighbor only when you agree.
And he's absolutely right. I got a lot of love for my mega family and friends out there. You're blindly wrong, but I love you. And we'll see what happens. A couple more from the president. Good to bring this one up, Jim. Where's all the election integrity questions? Apparently, when you win,
right,
it's all okay. Let's hear what the Biden had to say about it.
I also hope we can lay to rest the question about the integrity of the American electoral system.
Wait, what?
It is honest.
Is it?
It is fair.
Can't be.
And it is transparent.
Oh, my candidate lost. That must not be. Let's go to the Capitol. We'll be what? Oh, we're not doing that?
No, we're not.
We're accepting the fact that Harris lost. Are you sure? I mean.
Yes.
Okay.
And we no longer need to have commissions. We don't need to introduce legislation to change the way that voting is done. It may not be perfect, and yeah, there'll be a little hiccups here and there, but there are twosies and threesies around the country. There's no election fraud. We've known that now for years. And can we finally put that to rest? And frankly, just as a part of that, can those people who've been advocating and saying until Monday afternoon that the 2020 election was stolen, can we simply get acknowledged from you in the effort of reaching across the aisle to say, you know what, that was wrong. That was wrong.
You'll never get it. Don't hold your breath. Yeah. You know why Harris lost? Drop boxes. Mm-hmm.
Right.
855-752-4842. Just two more cuts from the president speaking today. Cut number 7, please.
Now we have 74 days to finish the term. Our term. Let's make every day count. That's the responsibility we have to the American people.
Make every day count. We got to do that every day, mm-hmm. every minute, every day, every breath we take. We can make a little bit of difference and be the people we want to see in government. Last one from the president, cut number 8.
Setbacks are unavoidable, but giving up is unforgivable. We all get knocked down. But the measure of our character, as my dad would say, is how quickly we get back up. Remember, a defeat does not mean we are defeated.
A defeat does not mean we are defeated. Joe Biden speaking today. Michelle from Oshkosh, she texts in, Joe Biden can bite me. He never should have run. He's the reason we are in this position. Yeah, there's a lot of reasons we're in this position, but mostly because more people voted for Trump than for Harris. I mean, come on, yeah. man. I mean, right. that's it. There's a lot of reasons, but that's the biggest one.
That's what it boils down to.
That's exactly right. And recall as well that the 2020 election, we can go back and revisit history there. Joe Biden did defeat Donald Trump. He did.
He did.
And he put an end at least to the first 4 years of that. Wonder out loud where we would have been if it had been a full 8 years. Well, arguably,
we're
going to find out now. Right. He at least restored some sense of what the presidency is, what a president can and should do. Look at all, again, I'm anticipating more of these tributes to the Biden years, all of the legislation that will continue to benefit this country for years.
True, yes.
And that too, is his legacy. We can talk about politics a lot, but he is also a president who has accomplished a huge amount. I put him in the same category with Jimmy Carter, also, again, defeated president after one term, but also accomplished an awful lot during his term.
Yeah, and he stayed alive to cast his vote.
He sure did.
You know, I can't help but think about, you know, of the consequential results of folks not leaving soon enough. Ruth Bader Ginsburg, for example, in this case, Joe Biden. I mean, if those things, if there have been some different timing of the retirements, people hanging on, though, Jim, they're just hanging on.
Right, exactly. And we know that there is history to this. I recall, as do all your listeners, Lyndon Johnson saying, again, because of the Vietnam War, choosing to add on to his speech to the people from the Oval Office, I made an additional decision here. I'm not running for the presidency now. He set up, obviously, the Humphrey-Nixon campaign. We know how that went, and the country went into Watergate after another term and a half or so. All kinds of history, but there are decisions.
Isn't that so, like, novel now? Like, right, Watergate?
Right, right, exactly, right, right. A bungled burglary, right? Right.
And the dude resigned over it.
Right. Exactly. And why? Because Republicans came to him and said, Mr. President, a bipartisan committee in the House of Representatives have got articles of impeachment. We can't defend you anymore. And the reality is you must go. Republicans said that to a Republican president. And that's when that Republican president got on that helicopter, waved the victory sign and was gone.
I am not a crook.
Right, right. And so, again, different time, not that long ago, yes, 40 years ago, but not that long ago in the history and recollection of many of us, including me. And plainly, America has changed in terms of the integrity yeah. of at least one of these parties to follow what should be done, basic presidentially.
It's the Pirates of the Caribbean, man. Steal what you can, right. Give nothing back.
Right. Right.
Let's get to the lines, 855-752-4842. Chris from Sun Prairie, you're up. Welcome, Chris. How you doing?
Hi.
Well, I have a different take on this than most people do about the election. I think that the reason that Kamala Harris lost was because of the fact that her whole party and the media threw the president under the bus two months before the election. Incumbency is a really huge part of winning an election. Anybody in political circles knows that. If the president had problems, like mentally, like they said, they should have taken him out with the 25th Amendment. If they were going to do this, they should have done months and months earlier than what they did. And I believe the people that won in this election are the people that are still going to get their tax cuts, the very rich, because the tax cuts for the very rich were ready to expire. And Biden was going to do a lot of good things for people, the working people of this country. He was going to follow through on some of the promises made to the Bernie delegates. You know, some of the things that we got into the platform for the Democratic Party, but that all got thrown under the bus. Every progressive thing got thrown under the bus by the party.
Okay, but let me ask you though. You know, it's Joe Biden's decision whether or not Joe Biden is going to run or not, and he made that decision.
It was not.
Sure, it was. It's always the candidate's decision. I don't buy it, man. No, Chris, I don't buy it.
Night and day. Why didn't they do it to Trump, what they did to him?
Well, I mean, hang on. I'm just telling you, you're blaming the party. And I certainly think the party has a lot to do with it. But Joe Biden is responsible for Joe Biden's decisions. Is he not?
Okay, so you have the news night and day.
I'm just asking you, Chris. Is Joe Biden responsible for Joe Biden's decisions? Yes or no?
He is, but how does a president go up against the media like that? The television used to be called the president's bully pulpit. We've lost that because now corporations control that. The United States has lost a lot, and we just lost our Constitution, and I don't know how anybody can be giddy about this, but the people who lost here are people of color, the LGBTQ community,
certainly.
Women,
there you go.
And people that are poor. Okay? And none of us are going to be in any good shape. We're going to lose our Social Security. They keep raising our age because they say we live longer. Us working people, we don't live longer. It's the rich that live longer. We don't get vacations. You know?
I hear you, Chris. Appreciate
you, Chris, you need to remain around so that when those things happen, you're able to articulate that to those groups that are, again, on the receiving end, the disadvantaged groups out there who are now not benefiting from the other programs and are fighting themselves out and alone without the government support that they've otherwise gotten in all these areas across the board.
Yeah, good points. Thank you, Chris. Thank you, Jim. And certainly some of the mega supporters will eventually find themselves perhaps not as well off as they would have hoped for.
The enthusiasm of today may well wane very quickly.
Well, time will tell. And I'm not betting against us. I hope it all works out. But we'll see. 855-752-4842. Come back with more of your phone calls as well.
You're listening to Civic Media. You can tune into any of our live shows on any radio station across the state with the Civic Media app. Find us in your phone's app store and listen anytime, anywhere.
And welcome back to the Dom Salvia Show, 855-752-4842. James Santelle, former U.S. Attorney, host of Amicus, the Law Review, broadcasting here on the Civic Media Radio Network on Saturdays, 9 to 11 a.m. at the desk with me, Jess P.S. on the board and on the horn. We're going to get back to the callers and the texters here briefly. Let's get to a couple ones. This is one that Steve from Lodi brings up, and I honestly got to tell you, I think about some of these things myself. Biden should become a dictator and have Trump arrested, put in prison. After that, Joe should step down and make Kamala POTUS, smiley face. While obviously I would absolutely disagree with that. I don't want a dictator regardless of if I think they're my dictator or your dictator. But that sentiment, man, it's like what in a more realistic situation. Right. And, we do have 74 days. What can this administration do to do something with guardrails?
Right. And so we've got a Supreme Court that has told Joe Biden that in those first pages of that opinion on July 1, that the presidency has got to be muscular and strong and nimble and be able to act quickly.
You know, I work out, Jim, right?
Exactly. Yeah, right. Right. And do all those kinds of things to ensure that the executive branch is just that, able to represent the people well and do it with again, great muscularity. And so Joe Biden in the next 74 days or so, do those things that the Supreme Court has told you you can do. My sense is without committing crimes, and I think you would agree with me, Dom, that we don't want him to commit crimes in America, but do those things that are strong. And that may include doing some budgetary things, some monetary things to ensure that programs are funded. Maybe Donald Trump will stop them at 12:05 on January 20th, but do it now. We've seen, again, during the course of the pandemic, by providing monies for impoverished families, we brought children out of poverty for the first time in America. Great, and tens of thousands of them.
Yeah.
We can do things. And I know people are going to be critical and saying, oh, you're just throwing money at that. But sometimes that's what we can do to improve the lives of people. Housing issues, education issues. I know he's been stopped by the Supreme Court and all those attempts to do loan forgiveness. You pursue everything inside every agency, every regulation you can possibly invoke to make things better for people. You push the envelope a bit. Yep. Don't commit crimes, but you push the envelope to make certain that the power that you've got right now is used to the benefit of people in a way that maybe you would have done at the end of your second term, but do it now. Do it now.
Wind them up and make them unwind it. Spend
Absolutely.
Some time and do what you can for
Absolutely.
The American people and do what you can with the executive power that you have between now and then to protect and defend the Constitution. Push the envelope. It's not only a great idea, it's your obligation
Absolutely.
As president to defend right. the Constitution. I can't believe Trump's going to go and put his hand on a Bible and take the oath, man. You got to be kidding me. I mean, are we just going to skip the whole thing? Because what does it really even matter? We're going to get into some of the cases. Let's get one or two more calls in here. 855-752-4842. Annie from Watertown, you're next. Welcome, Annie. What do you got for us?
Oh, it's been a while. Yeah, don't throw money at people unless they're rich people. Then you can throw money at them.
Right.
Before I get to my point that I call about, Dom said you had a better quote of something that the Pirates of the Caribbean.
Yeah.
Is that what you quoted?
Steal what you can, give nothing back. Yeah.
Yeah, because I was thinking something else. Joe Biden quoted his father on something. Now, I was thinking, boy, what will Donald Trump quote his father about? Like, well, I thought of some things, but what you said is better. Sure. But earlier, you were talking about the Democratic Party having a hard time reaching people. And I have gone through this where people think, I've been on both ends, you know, where people think you're talking down to them mm-hmm. and this and that. And it's very complicated. I mean, you could do a couple hours on that
it
one,
is.
You know?
It's very complicated.
How to deal with it, because I recently had a very good discussion with somebody very close to me where she thought I was always talking down to her and everything. It's like, well, no, you know, this is something that I was just saying. I didn't. And it has more to do with how people hear than how you're putting it out.
It can certainly be both, Annie, certainly.
Yeah. Yeah. And I don't know. It was before Trump, certainly Fox News. But in the last couple of decades, I have heard some people who are what you consider smart, intelligent, professional, educated, they've been really stupid.
Right.
It really doesn't have anything to do with education or that, you know, they've been just as gullible and taken and snowed over. And I mean, how can you see something and say, oh, that's not what he said?
Right. Anyway, we didn't see his tweets.
Right. January 6th was not, in fact, a day of love. No. Right, Annie? Right.
No,
right.
It was right? Not.
Or here's the alternative, Annie, that they're reading from, singing from a songbook, a playbook, right? They know better. They're the intellectual people who are smart, as you describe them. They know better, but they've got a larger mission. And that is, if I say it out loud and I say it on Fox News, maybe people will believe it. And maybe I carry some credibility by saying that and I can accomplish what I want. And maybe I'll become appointed Secretary of Commerce in the next administration. That's a very, very cynical view, I know, but that could also be the motivation for those smart people saying things that have got to be obviously known as wrong.
855-752-4842. Mark from the SAC, you're up. Welcome, Mark. What do you got for us?
Yeah, well, thanks. And let's remember, the Republican Party chose a man, putting the other things aside, a man who was an admitted sexual assaulter and an adjudicated rapist. That's the guy they chose. That's the guy they continue to support. And that shows the integrity of the Republican Party. And as Hamilton warned in 70, that, and he was addressing the people's fears, that, of course, the Supreme Court has now done it. They've established an aristocracy, a monarchy, and a despotism in Donald Trump that's going to be our despot in chief. And for CJ and Dan and Gary, that Gary, who admitted he wouldn't trust Donald Trump with his daughters, but he's trusting him with the keys of power in this country. I mean, that I can remember Gary saying that. Wouldn't trust Trump with my daughters, but I'll trust him with the country. Well,
we've got him. We've got him now, right? Right.
Now we've got him. Thank you for the call, Mark. Appreciate it. Always 855-752-4842. I'll get back to more calls, but we're going to dive into what remains the ashes of these criminal cases. With James Santelle. Stick around.
You're an organ donor, right? Well, here's a tragic fact. Approximately 20 people die each day waiting for precious donated organs. You could make a life-saving decision simply by getting that important dot on your driver's license. That little dot shows those who need to know that you've made a decision to donate organs at a critical time. Go to heroicdeed.com to learn more about the importance of organ donation and how you can make your wishes known. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. HeroicDeed.com.
And welcome back to the Dom Salvia Show, 855-752-4842, 855-75-CIVIC. James Santelle, former U.S. attorney at the table with me. Jess P.S. on the boards. Callers, be patient. We will get you. I want to get Jim's opinion on the status of some of these civil and criminal cases that are pending against the former and soon-to-be President Donald Trump.
It is tough to say out loud, isn't it? Right, right.
I don't think I've said it out loud yet.
Oh, what,
It's a passage, Jess. It's a passage.
I've written it. I haven't said it out loud yet.
Do we have to call him? We don't have to call him that. We can call him like a rapist or something, can't we?
We can use accurate titles, so yes.
We can call him a convicted felon.
There we go.
Yeah.
WMDX texter 920. Is it disrespectful to address Donald Trump as the future first felon in chief?
There's legal support for that for doing just that, right? Right. And there's a point, if I can use that good text as a springboard. It is a stunning thing to say it out loud, Jess, but in 19 days from now, the president-elect of the United States of America is going to be appearing in a Manhattan court to be sentenced by a criminal judge for 34 counts of violations of the criminal law in New York. That's going to happen. Unless Juan Merchan, in which case I'm going to be all over the criticism of him, right? Unless Juan Merchan, and he should not. And I hope that he does not postpone this further. He's done it twice already. But absent that, Juan Merchan needs to go ahead and sentence the president-elect of the United States of America for the crimes that he committed against the people of the state of New York. Isn't that a stunning thing to say out loud?
It really is. Jim, if Juan Merchan doesn't do that and cancels it, you're gonna come over into the dark side. We're gonna start a gang, man.
I may, in fact, have to move over to that side of the desk, Dom. Yeah. Right, and Justin and I will both be moving over to that
That's
side of the
right.
desk.
We're
right?
gonna go rob some right? gas stations tonight, baby.
Right.
No, it is stunning. I mean, come on, man. I mean, we talk about Richard Nixon stepping down because of that.
Right.
And here we have this one of many cases. So.
Civil cases.
Civil cases. On the sentencing, though, let's assume it goes forward.
Right.
He sentenced him to 30 days in jail. Mm-hmm. It'll out on appeal, out on bail. What happens?
A couple of things. One is he'll almost certainly stay it, and I would not be critical for doing that. He will not be sending Donald Trump to jail, so he can't attend.
But he could.
He could.
Okay, he could.
He could.
So I am now saying, Juan Merchan, if you do sentence him to jail, you should send him right then and there.
Exactly. He can order that. What will happen, of course, is his attorneys will run immediately to the appeals court and ask for a stay of that. Chances are the appeals court will
do
we'll
it on a Friday. Make him cool as heels. Over the weekend, you know, you get them out on Monday.
Right.
Sorry, so we're closed. It's a holiday.
You're thinking like somebody who knows the system well, Dom, right? Exactly. But appeals court will almost certainly stay that because there will be some issues about the trial itself. And beyond that, assuming that Juan Merchan does not stay it, this goes up in appeal. And so it'll be several years before that will be completely adjudicated. The significant thing about that, of course, is the state case. By the way, Juan Merchan sometime next week is also going to issue his own order on whether or not that Supreme Court immunity ruling requires him to get rid of the case. Again, prediction here, he will not buy into that theory, but that may be as soon as next week. So something to talk about when we get together then.
All right.
But assuming that Juan Merchan does what he should now do to bring this thing to a close in the district court, it'll be pending out there for a while, but again, wouldn't it be stunning? The second portion of this is today, whenever that is, November 26th is the date, right before Thanksgiving, the president-elect was sentenced to 30 days in prison. And again, not going to be executed anytime soon, but that too.
Wait, executed?
Right. won't
Seems
be taken
pretty
away.
Harsh for fraud, Jim.
Will not be taken away in any handcuffs at
All
that
right.
time.
All right.
But that's what's going on there. Appeals will continue for months, if not years, beyond that. And that's one, of course, because it's a state offense, a state conviction, not subject to the pardon authority that Donald Trump has. He cannot direct the DA or anybody in law enforcement there in New York to do something, which he could do for those federal cases, both in D.C. and in Fort Pierce in South Florida.
So if they are civil cases or they are state cases, even if they're criminal, Trump has less influence on the outcome of those particular cases.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right.
There are some civil suits, and some of them, of course, specifically E. Jean Carroll, the defamation. Right. We talked about the civil fraud case. There are some cases against him filed by, like, police officers and Dem lawmakers for Trump's efforts in overthrowing the government. What happens with those?
Those proceed apace, right? And that's, again, civil litigation. That's the kind of thing that the president, because they're private lawsuits, they're pending in federal court for the most part. That's not a situation where the Department of Justice has authority over them. An attorney general can't reach in and get rid of those cases. They're being brought by, in some cases, private officials, private people, sometimes public officials, but they're lawsuits that are not generated and not animated by the Department of Justice. President can't do anything about those. Certainly can appeal, can judgments against him down the road, but those should also remain in effect. Again, not subject to any pardon authority there. That's all criminal stuff, and those cases should go ahead.
Okay, so the other one would be the state case. We're talking about the state case in Georgia. Fani Willis, still, I guess, ultimately on appeal, whether or not she can actually remain on the case. I mean, this thing's in its infancy yet, this RICO case.
It
now, there's
is.
A lot of other folks indicted with him in this RICO case, so How does that flush out?
Sure. So right now, again, exactly that, Dom, the decision of Scott McAfee, who was the state court judge there. Yeah. He's the one who said, you know what, I don't like what you did, Fani. This looks kind of bad, but it's not a conflict of interest, so stay on the case. Donald Trump and others among that great number of defendants in that RICO case, sweeping case, appeal that to the appeals court there. That's where it's pending right now. That case, also a state case, not subject to Donald Trump's getting rid of it somehow through the Department of Justice. There's another thing we should talk about, though, in connection with all of that. But that can also, that'll also be subject to some resolution probably late this year, maybe early next year, by the appeals court there in Georgia. Almost certainly, I like to think, saying that the Scott McAfee's decision, which was, again, well thought out, that stands. She can stay on the case. She also, may recall, appealed Scott McAfee's dismissal of some counts. Remember this? And that's also pending. So we're going to get a couple of things coming out of the appeals court there. Again, a state case. And again, it could proceed in sometime into 2025. The footnote that I've sort of hinted at before is just this. When it comes to prosecutions and certainly sentencings, those kinds of things, even in the federal system, there's sort of a there is a doctrine inside the Department of Justice that says we don't prosecute sitting presidents. Doesn't directly apply to state prosecutions, but you know well that defense counsel will raise that issue and attempt to stop that prosecution in Georgia from going ahead while Donald Trump is the incumbent in the White House. There is also a notion out there that if the state of Georgia, for example, were somehow to sentence him during the course of his term and literally send people out there to get him in the handcuffs, that might be, again, think about this. It's never been tested. We don't do this, but I haven't done this before, that because that would be some state action, effectively overcoming the, forgive me for describing it this way, the will of the remaining states, the will of the people, and basically stopping a president from doing what he's supposed to do, that you would have to stay, that is, postpone any, again, execution of that state case until after he leaves the White House. And again, all that, that's all theory. Nobody has ever tested that. It's not been before the Supreme Court. There is a non-frivolous argument about the notion that a single state prosecution should not overcome the decision by the American public to put somebody in the White House. That's a national federal decision. And again,
states' rights, baby. What are you talking about,
and
man?
That's the argument, right?
It's so bad, too bad you voted for a felon who tried to overthrow the government. The people of Georgia were harmed by this.
Right. People of New York were harmed by something
exactly.
as well. So you've got those arguments out there. It is the kind of thing that, again, could animate our discussions, my friend, well into 2025 as we think about all of these things we never had to think about for presidents who are not subject to criminal prosecutions in state courts. This is unprecedented in American history.
I can't wait to be president. It's going to be great. James Santelle, former U.S. attorney. Okay, let's get to the federal cases then. Of course, the documents case, the mother lode, the secret documents that Trump hoarded as the billionaire hoards in his house, even after swearing or notifying or testifying or writing that, oh, we gave everything back, it's all fine. That case, the Jack Smith case, and of course also Tanya Chutkan on the D.C. insurrection case. The headlines I'm seeing, Jim, says looks like Smith's getting ready to pack his bags.
He's packing up, apparently, and we don't know if that's absolutely certain. The status of the documents case, of course, is that you've got Eileen Cannon, who could be on a short list either for Attorney General or maybe a next Supreme Court spot.
God,
think about that just to make yourself feel good about your nation here. She has dismissed that case entirely on the unfounded, again, unprecedented notion that Jack Smith didn't have authority. Clarence Thomas is the only person who's bought into that crazy theory. It's up before the 11th Circuit Court of Appeals. They will almost certainly reverse her. And I would offer to you, Dom, that it's important that they do that for a couple of reasons. One is you don't want that precedent out there that you can get rid of a special counsel, special prosecutor like this. It's important for the department to establish that as a moving and active theory out there. And then you also, for reasons just beyond that theory, you want to send a message about Eileen Cannon. She's done it again. She is out there alone. And the 11th Circuit, which is not exactly a liberal circuit, not as conservative as the 5th Circuit is, but 11th Circuit coming back and once again telling her, Eileen, you're wrong about this. And maybe in some way that dampens some spirit about her next job employment, maybe in Washington. But all those things, they're still out there. The issue that you just raised is just this, and that is the Department of Justice has this, again, not, it's not in stone, it's not legislative, it's not constitutional, that you can't prosecute a sitting president. Donald Trump right now is not sitting. And so maybe there's some thought that Jack Smith with Merrick Garland are going to say, let's dismiss this now and bring this to an end.
No!
My own advocacy is, you know what? Let's go with the Tanya Chutkan approach. Let's move full speed ahead. Tanya, issue your order. 11th Circuit, issue your order. And if it's going to happen, let's have Donald Trump, law and order guy, be the one through his attorney general who says, I want those cases dismissed. Let him do that. Let the American people hear that their president is reaching down Pennsylvania Avenue and telling an attorney general to dismiss indictments that were legitimately returned by 26 people in grand juries, finding probable cause that there were crimes committed by this president. Let Donald Trump do that. Let's not do that on Merrick Garland's watch.
Just 2 minutes left in the segment, Jim. What happens to the evidence, grand jury testimony, all the things in these cases? Do we ever get to see any of it?
You might. Again, you as a member of the media could petition for some of those things. Much of it otherwise would have been a part of the public domain if any of these things had gone to trial. Again, the Georgia case may still be tried at some point, but it will remain there. And certainly at some point, even historians may say, you know what, time has passed. I can now make a petition to the court, grand jury materials, release this as a part of the general informational interest of the American people. Eventually you can get it.
The Georgia case, even if it was stalled or delayed because Trump is president, what happens to his co-conspirators in the RICO case?
Right, and there's the other interesting issue we haven't resolved, right? Probably should go ahead with them. And Scott McAfee, again, assuming that the appeals court lets Fannie Willis go ahead, he's got this back, and he may say, you know what, I'm bifurcating, there's your legal word for the afternoon, I'm bifurcating this trial. Donald Trump, he's in the White House, we're not trying him, but everybody else, pull out your calendars. Let's schedule this on for trial. They are not subject to those kinds of immunity doctrines. At least that's not what Scott McAfee is, right?
And his co-conspirators would not be eligible for a presidential pardon.
That's exactly right. That's exactly. State case once again. And so a lot of people there still are not looking at this election as being the get-out-of-jail-free card.
You lay with the dogs, you get the fleas. Folks, this is the Dom Salvia Show. That is James Santelle. Jess P.S. on the board. Come back. Take some of your calls. 855-752-4842.
You're listening to Civic Media. Find the latest news, information, and archives of all your favorite shows on the Civic Media website, civicmedia.us.
And welcome back to the Dom Salvia Show, last segment of the day. If you got something to say, hit us up on the lines right now, 844-855-752-4842, 855-75-CIVIC. Hard to forget that old telephone number I had for 15, 12 years, 855-752-4842. Let's get to the phones and the text. Annie wonders, or says, please unredact Mueller report now. How do we call Garland? There has been some release of these things. Any chance that we can see those?
Right. I think Annie's got a good point here that, again, the statute of limitations, by the way, has long passed on all that for the purposes of
history, baby.
Right. It is history for what it's worth. When did the statute of limitations on the obstruction of justice charges under the Mueller report, when did those expire? During the Garland administration, right? You had about 6 months to indict there. Didn't do that either. Okay. So the answer is
law and order my ass.
There you go, right? So the answer, Annie, is yes, you can make those requests. You can make a Freedom of Information Act FOIA request. You can do that. You may want to, you may end up suing again to get some of that. The notion, the principal argument, once again, would be no prosecution possible here. Grand jury issues, yeah, maybe there's some issues there about national security could be there, maybe some witness issues. But the reasons for keeping it secret pretty much now gone away.
Before we get to the callers, guy came on, I forget his name, author talking about, did an interview with Epstein, who said that, you know, Trump was his best friend, said all these things, and said that, you know, there are a bunch of pictures in the safe at Epstein in place. You know, those, what happens with that kind of stuff? I mean, if there were to be not just Trump, but some of any of those folks that were involved with Epstein that, I mean, dude apparently hung himself, you know, in jail, is that information all going to get destroyed? Is any of that would ever come out? Does the FBI hang on to that?
Sure. The answer is yes. The FBI, all law enforcement, with the exception maybe of the smallest law enforcement agency out there in America, those files are existent, and they remain in place virtually in perpetuity, especially now that we've got electronics, right, where we can put them on ways in which we can store them virtually indefinitely. They're out there for just this reason. And so, again, depending upon the case involving his co-conspirator there, that's still out there. But as to Jeffrey Epstein himself, obviously the defendant is now dead. He killed himself, as you indicated. Same kind of thing.
Allegedly,
right? Right. Petitions for the release of those, making a claim that there is an interest in the American public about knowing that, knowing the people who also may have been engaged in some criminal conduct. There may even be, again, we don't know about it, some continuing focus on those criminal sides of things.
Yeah,
know that. We shouldn't know that. That could still be out there. But again, issue is statute of limitations. At some point, that runs too. And presumably Jeffrey Epstein's company, the conspiratorial group.
Yeah, so you get away with the 12-year-olds on your lap legally, but that probably wouldn't be great politically. I'm just saying.
Absolutely.
If that were to be the case.
And a public interest in knowing that, there's a legitimate interest in knowing that with respect to the people we elect to public office. I say that about in the wake of what we just did on Tuesday.
855-752-4842. Mary from Wauwatosa, you are up. Welcome, Mary. What do you got for us?
Thanks, Dom and Jim, for the coverage. We really need this. We've all had, you know, a short time to think about the election results, and our minds have been working overtime. You know, when we sleep, ideally to give our brains a break, it continues to process. And the words that came to me immediately when I woke up this morning were buyer's remorse. I considered what that meant, and I would suggest, especially for the voters who voted on a one or simplistic issue, that as time goes on, they're going to see that they bought a total package, including democracy destruction. And it might be very rather startling concerning this that the Democrats, you know, knew ahead of time. Your thoughts?
My thought is absolutely that is the case, that when you put together again all these pieces from the Supreme Court, from the Constitution, from what Donald has committed to doing, you've got an incredibly powerful president, not just in what we've been talking about this afternoon, appointments, those kinds of things. But what do you do with that? You make policy different, and on immigration, on education, on health care, on commerce. We think about Ukraine. We think about Taiwan, about all these places around the world. And buyer's remorse, we may not have it right away, but a major portion of the population may come May, June, July, when we've had 6 months of this and we see things, the impacts, and they're going to be acting quickly. Absolutely. We may, in fact, have at least some portion of that population saying, gosh, maybe we should have paid more attention to what he was saying along the way. Maybe we are remorseful for putting him in the White House.
I did see a headline today that Donald Trump essentially saying there is no budgetary number, no amount of money he won't spend to do the deportation activity. 855-752-4842. L.A. Tom, you're next. Welcome, Tom. What do you got?
Yeah, what these voters who voted for Trump don't understand, and maybe they will someday, and mark my words on this, because I think this will come to be true, but we're also fighting for them.
Absolutely.
We're fighting for democracy for everybody.
James Santelle, thoughts?
There you go. And all these amazing programs to help people who need the safety nets in housing, in education, in healthcare, all those kinds of things. If those are compromised, as they may well be compromised in the coming months, we are a part of a nation. We are a nation that supports everybody. If they're no longer there, that's the problem you're identifying.
James Santelle, former U.S. attorney, host of Amicus, a law review here on the Civic Media Radio Network, 9 to 11 a.m. on Saturday. Jim, thank you so much for hanging out with
Always
me today.
Always delightful to be with you, my friend.
Jess P.S. on the board. Thank you. And just Andrew, for the record, Jess and I both pick out the bumper music. Glad you like it. folks, Earl Ingram Jr. coming up with me tomorrow. Stick around. Pete Schwab with Nightlight coming up next.
The national news cycle never stops, but it can be hard to find news about your local community. Civic Media is dedicated to providing quality local and state news coverage across Wisconsin. With the Civic Media app, you can get notifications about local stories that matter to you and your community. Find the free Civic Media app in your phone's app store and choose notifications from the menu to tell us what kind of news you want to hear about.